Καλησπέρα σε όλους. Άνοιξη του 2010, η Ρωμαιοκαθολική Εκκλησία συγκλονίζεται από τις αποκαλύψεις σε παγκόσμιο επίπεδο για χιλιάδες υποθέσεις σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης με πρωταγωνιστές καθολικούς ιερείς. Την ώρα που η διεθνής κοινή γνώμη παρακολουθεί σοκαρισμένη τη διστακτικότητα του Βατικανού να αναγνωρίσει αυτή την εφιαλτική πραγματικότητα, στην Ιρλανδία χιλιάδες φωνές μιλούν για δικαίωση και για μια πρωτοφανή συγκάλυψη που πηγαίνει πολλά χρόνια πίσω, έως το 1917.
The first documented complaint in Ireland was 1917. In 1922, which is the year our state was founded and the church practically wrote the constitution, there was enough concern that a set of instructions were issued from the higher echelons of the Vatican. Part of what they were told was that the cleric taking complaints and the victim making complaints had to sign an oath of silence and secrecy under threat of excommunication. The same document was reissued in 1962, only it started to cover convents also. In 1940, the first treatment centers for paedophile priests were opened, right? So they all knew for decades and decades. That you had any association with the rape of a child or the cover-up of a rape of a child, how could you live with yourself? You couldn't live with yourself.
This man just out there sexually abusing me. Jesus, these men had the audacity. Just start quoting Jesus and Jesus' pain to me after the pain he's giving me.
He was trying to put his hands around my private area, and then once he realized that I wasn't saying anything or doing anything or responding, then over a period of time he just became more comfortable doing that.
As a young child, I was abused by a Christian brother, and later in life I was abused by a priest.
I went to talk to a priest in my parish, and he wouldn't take the name of my abuser. He wouldn't take the name of the chaplain, and he told me that it was probably my fault.
Until the philosophy which holds one race superior and another inferior.
Had you planned it to do that on camera, or was it something that...
No, I planned it. Well, to me it was great because I was able to stand up and say who I am and what I represent, and that I'm not a pop star. I wasn't in music so that I could be a pop star. I wasn't attracted to music so I could be a pop star. I was attracted to music so I could stand for what I believe in.
We have confidence in the victory of good over evil. Fight the real enemy.
Like, if you picture for a second in your head a little boy you know being raped, and ask yourself, is his humility, you know, can it be compared to the fucking humility of these people with all their riches and all their la 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 and their lies, and they're not actually accepting what happened? They should have been on their knees roaring crying. They should have been the ones who first publicised it. It shouldn't have been that the victims had to spend years bashing the door down.
I grew up in Dublin, in a working class area, and a nice part of Dublin, and I was living at home, obviously, and I always wanted to be a priest from a very young age, and the obvious thing to do at a young age in Dublin for boys was to become an altar boy, and I would have been about, you know, 9 or 10. And then Father Payne, he didn't wear black at all, and he only wore his collar occasionally. So he sort of looked, came across as quite trendy in those days, and some people called him very charismatic, and that gave him an added kudos, if you like, and made him that bit more special. Normally during the summertime, there'd be an 8 o'clock morning mass, but there would be no altar boys at it. But he asked the sacristan in the church to ask for a couple of boys to serve the mass. I think he asked for a couple of boys in particular. And so I was happy to be asked to do it, and I went around and did it. So that gave him a way to have me down in the house on my own. And then he would start sort of putting his arms around you, or giving you a hug, or maybe tickling you then. And over time, I ended up sitting on his couch, and you'd be watching television. So it ended up basically with he was very surreptitiously trying to put his hands around my private area. So what I decided to do as a child was just to focus, regardless of what Father Payne was doing to me, was just to focus on the television. And that was my coping mechanism.
I was born in Dublin, grew up in Dublin. I had one brother, an older brother, and my mum and dad, and my father's parents. We grew up all together in the one house, very happy as a child. Went to school, and I enjoyed school. And then I became ill with osteomyelitis in my arm, and I had to go into hospital. I had the operation. I wasn't too well after the operation. I was running a fever and things, but the chaplain was a young priest, and he made me very feel very safe, because it was my first time away from home, and he used to come talk to me and sort of paid special attention to me, and I felt very lucky that he was being friendly with me more so than other children on the ward. But he used to come and read to me in the evenings when the other children would be sort of settling down to sleep. And he would send the nurse from the ward off to have a cup of tea or something. The reading developed into he wanted to play games of a certain type, and that gave him eventually access to me. And on the pretext of playing a game, he began to interfere with me physically and then sexually, and basically he was abusing me sexually.
This place, Dangan, it was like Devil's Island. That's what it was like. And because your parents couldn't come and visit you, the brothers who ran the place, the priests, they, you had to do whatever they said. And you lived at their permission. You breathed at their permission. They controlled you. They did everything they wanted to do to you. These were evil people. These were evil times. Many of the children who were here were only orphans. No mother, no father. But in my case, because my brother and somebody stole some chocolate and gave me the chocolate, I was sent here for 2 years. But it wasn't just 2 years here. It was 2 years of sexual abuse, physical abuse, and emotional abuse. They preached God and made us go to Mass every morning. They did not act like God. In fact, God was taken away from me down here. I lost my God in Dangan. I find it traumatic coming back here. I go back as an adult, but the memories come back as a child. So I become a child again. And then all the nightmares and all the fear still come back, and I'm still an adult. I'm a man. I'm a very old man now, but it all comes back to me.
Μέχρι πρόσφατα, τα εκκλησιαστικά τάγματα στην Ιρλανδία και οι επισκοπές της χώρας αρνούνταν να συνεργαστούν για την διερεύνηση αυτών των καταγγελιών. Μέλη των ταγμάτων και κληρικοί δεν ήθελαν να ακούσουν τις μαρτυρίες των θυμάτων, δεν αναγνώριζαν καν τα ίδια τα θύματα. Από την άλλη, η αστυνομία, οι εισαγγελικές αρχές, οι Ιρλανδοί πολιτικοί έκλειναν τα μάτια επί δεκαετίες σε αυτό το πρωτοφανές σκάνδαλο που το 1994 θα έριχνε την κυβέρνηση της χώρας. Μόλις πριν από ένα χρόνο δημοσιοποιήθηκαν τα συμπεράσματα των ερευνών που αναγκάστηκε να διεξάγει η πολιτεία όταν οι ψήθυροι έγιναν κραυγές.
I was crossing there. And he said, come. And I said, what? He said, you shouldn't be out on your own. I said, I was sent. Oh, you weren't. Come in here. So he brought me in there and he beat me. And then he had a habit from there down. And he dragged me down, but he was beating me. And then he loosened his trousers and he put my face to him. And he was beating me, but he made me do things. And he had no compulsion. He had no remorse. We know nothing. So these two buildings here represent a lot of fear for me. It brings back the child in me. And I feel very bitter. I feel very angry because it now comes back home. What happened in these buildings and then what I was forced to do in the other buildings. In the other buildings is worse. But I will show you when we go through these doors what was even worse. Forget about being raped, sexually assaulted. What was worse than that? Because they dehumanized you. They would tell you your father doesn't love you, your mother doesn't love you, that they were your parents, and you are a core as explained, is a wild animal. So you're not human. This is where you come in at night and go upstairs, the dormitories. But this is the worst part of the lot, here, to here, and back. Because when you went up at night, you'd be terrified. Who would be next? Because you could hear here, when the child was flogged here, naked, you could hear the screams in the bedrooms. So all the children could hear. You could hear the noise, look. Hollow. So imagine a whip. I said, I was upstairs and I heard Ashmore. And he said, who was going to escape with you? He said, Kelly, Kelly, Kelly. So I knew now, this is my time. For a long time, brother, 6 months, I was dreading it would be me. Now it's going to be me. So they brought him up and he was screaming, really screaming. So that made it more terrifying for me before it happened to me. When I came down, his brother got me, throw you on the stairs, pull the nitrous over, stand on your hands, you kneel down, stand on your hands, so you can't move. And then the man, Fitzpatrick, the big whip, he would run from here. And run like that. From morning to night, it was fear. Fear. That's the worst part, the fear. Not the beatings, not the rape, the sexual assault. The fear that it will happen. Fear. And sometimes, you know, fear of not being loved. You weren't cherished, but you would try to be cherished. You would actually then try to be cherished by them. So you believed you were the animal. You would want to be. You wanted to be nice to the master, so he wouldn't hit you, but he'd give you treats. But that, to me, is the most evilest thing to do to a human being.
It was at its height in the 1950s. You had about between 7,000 and 8,000 children within the industrial school system at any one time. Overall, you've had 150,000 children go through that, and they set out to break them, and they did very successfully through vicious emotional, psychological and physical abuse. And then on top of that, you had sadistic sexual abuse. So we had a pretty grotesquely dysfunctional society, and children suffered savagely as a result of it. You had an extraordinary situation where you had this complete aberration at the heart of a society that kind of did believe that it was the holiest. We did believe we were the holiest people in the whole world, that we were the most Catholic, we were the most Christian, we were the Pope's favourite people. You know, no other country was as Catholic as we were. We were 99% Catholic, and God help the 1% who weren't. We kind of did, and we were the land of saints and scholars, and we sort of did believe that.
Στην Ιρλανδία, η παρουσία της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας καθόρισε την εθνική ταυτότητα, διαμόρφωσε το εκπαιδευτικό σύστημα, συνέβαλε στη δημιουργία της καθολικής μεσαίας τάξης. Τον 20ο αιώνα και μετά την ανεξαρτησία της χώρας, το 1922, η καθολική ηθική κοινωνία έγινε η Ιρλανδική κοινωνία. Τότε η πολιτεία αποφάσισε να επιδοτήσει την Εκκλησία και να της παραχωρήσει την ευθύνη κυρίως στους τομείς της εκπαίδευσης και της υγείας.
For those decades in Ireland, you really didn't touch the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church were an immense power in the land, and I mean, I've compared it. I suppose the closest thing really is that you could look at, and it's not too extreme a comparison, is to the Taliban and to that sort of religious control, moral control of a society.
Η Μέρι Ράφτερη είναι η δημιουργός δύο ντοκιμαντέρ που έσπασαν τον κύκλο της σιωπής στην Ιρλανδία. Το 2002 αποκάλυψε τα περιστατικά σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης που συγκάλυπτε για χρόνια το Ιρλανδικό κράτος και η Αρχιεπισκοπή του Δουβλίνου. Τρία χρόνια νωρίτερα, το 1999, έφερε στο φως τις κτηνοδίες των εκκλησιαστικών ταγμάτων της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας σε αναμορφωτήρια, ορφανοτροφία και εκπαιδευτικά ιδρύματα.
These institutions where these so many thousands of children were abused were in every little town. They were in every town around the country. Everybody knew about them, but people didn't ask any questions. They couldn't sort of deal with the enormity of what it is they might suspect.
Το αναμορφωτήριο του Σεν Κόνλεθ στο Ντέγκεν ήταν ένα από αυτά τα ιδρύματα. Εδώ από το 1940 έως το 1973 φυλακίστηκαν περισσότερα από 5.000 παιδιά ηλικίας από 11 έως 17 ετών. Το ίδρυμα διοικούσαν τα μέλη του χριστιανικού τάγματος των αφιερωμένων στην Άσπηλη Μαρία. Ο Τζον Κέλλι, πρόεδρος σήμερα της οργάνωσης παιδιών που επέζησαν από κακοποίηση, στάλθηκε σε αυτό το κολαστήριο για 2 χρόνια. Ήταν μόλις 12 ετών.
Because I can still see him bearing down like that, precise, and going for parts of the body that would hurt. So I can imagine, and I was so shocked. Now I realized, what is this place? I'd never seen that. I'd never seen such violence before. And it wasn't ordinary violence. Passed out. Because you were so tired hitting this child. This was a big, big, big man. He used to do weights, and he'd have a ball sometimes, he used to call it for playing handball, and he'd squeeze these in his hands like that for his muscles. And then he used me as an excuse for being wet and dirty to get me into the shower. Well, something else happened. Very sinister, very bad. And when I was bleeding and when I was blood coming from me and I was crying, pain, This was the man, he said to me. Christ gave me a whack. Whoosh, back of his hand, like that. He said, Christ died for you, you little cur, that word, animal. He said, Christ died for you, and you sit there crying and in pain. He talked about nails in Christ's hands. This man just out there sexually abusing me. These men had the audacity to start quoting Jesus and Jesus' pain to me after the pain he's giving me, and then told me I must shut up.
Καθημερινά, τα παιδιά σαν να ήταν βαρυπινίτες κατάδικοι, υποχρεώνονταν να δουλεύουν σε φάρμες. Η διοίκηση του Ιδρύματος πωλούσε τα αγροτικά προϊόντα στην τοπική αγορά και συγκέντρωνε χρήματα. Το Ντέγκεν ήταν στην πραγματικότητα μια φυλακή καταναγκαστικών έργων. Ένα στρατόπεδο τύπου Auschwitz στο ολοκαύτωμα του καθολικισμού. Οι νεαροί κρατούμενοι μπορεί να μην είχαν στολές, αλλά είχαν αριθμούς. Ο Κέλλι ήταν ο αριθμός 253.
Now, every item of your clothes, you would have a jacket, small jacket, insufficient to protect you. A number, your number. Your shirt, your number. Your vest, under vest, your number. Your underpants, your vest. Trousers, your number. Your socks, your number. Your boots, your number. But when I was released, I wasn't happy. I was fretful. I thought somebody would take me back. I hurried down waiting on the bus. I even wet myself waiting on the bus. And even when I got home, I was out for a week, 10 days. I jumped on the train with them to Britain. Didn't tell my mother, didn't tell my parents, my brothers, nobody. And I remained there for 33 years. I always thought, even when in England, they would take me back here. I slept on benches in Hyde Park in the rain and the snow, but I felt safe.
I was very confused. I was very, very confused and began to feel that it was something wrong with me that was making it all happen. I didn't say it to anybody because I suppose after it had happened a couple of times, I thought that what he's doing is wrong, but I felt very ashamed and it just, I didn't want anybody to know really that this was happening to me.
Η Μέρι Κόλινς ήταν 12 ετών όταν χειρουργήθηκε στην παιδιατρική κλινική Κράμλιν του Δουβλίνου. Η κακοποίησή της από τον εφημέριο που λειτουργούσε στο παρεκκλήσι του νοσοκομείου ήταν μόνο η αρχή.
He took photographs of me as part of the abuse, and that was probably the worst part of the abuse because I felt so degraded, and I wouldn't have had those words then, but I just felt dreadful. And when I left the hospital, I worried a lot about what had happened to the photographs he took. I went back to school, and I'd been very popular in school. I'd been very happy in school. But I went back to school, and I was just so scared and frightened that the other girls would know.
Τα Χριστούγεννα, ο ιερέας έστειλε στην νεαρή κοπέλα μία από αυτές τις φωτογραφίες μαζί με μια ευχετήρια κάρτα. Η Κόλινς πνιγόταν στην τροπή. Κλείστηκε στον εαυτό της. Απομακρύνθηκε από τον αδερφό, τον πατέρα της, από τα αγόρια της ηλικίας της. Παντρεύτηκε λίγα χρόνια αργότερα, έκανε ένα παιδί, αλλά παρέμεινε βυθισμένη στη σιωπή και στην κατάθλιψη που συνοδευόταν από κρίσεις πανικού.
So the first person I ever spoke to was a doctor. And then I told my husband. And then my next act was to go and tell the church. But I went to talk to a priest in my parish, and I told him what had happened, and he wouldn't take the name of my abuser, he wouldn't take the name of the chaplain, and he told me that it was probably my fault. And he told me that I could forget about it now because I was forgiven. I was so distraught, I just couldn't speak to anybody again. I just stopped. I wouldn't talk to anybody, and it was another 10 years before I spoke about it again.
Αρχές της δεκαετίας του 90 η Ιρλανδία συγκλονίζεται από τις αποκαλύψεις για τον ιερέα Brendan Smith. Ο Smith κακοποιούσε παιδιά στην Ιρλανδία, τη Σκωτία και τις Ηνωμένες Πολιτείες επί 40 χρόνια. Η Ιρλανδική Καθολική Εκκλησία απλώς τον μετέθεται από τη μία ενορία στην άλλη. Ο δημοσιογράφος των Irish Times, Πάτσι Μαγκάρι, θυμάται.
He was originally detained in Northern Ireland in 1993 and jailed there. He was then extradited down to the Republic of Ireland in 1998 and jailed here and died within a month of being sentenced to, I think, just 12 years here at that time. And it caused quite a sensation at the time that he had gone on abusing children for so long, and that the response of the church authorities was simply to move him every time there was a complaint. And in fact, that scandal was of such a degree that later that year it brought down a government in 1994 because it was alleged that the Attorney General's office hadn't handled requests for his extradition to Northern Ireland satisfactorily.
Εκείνη την περίοδο η Mary Collins βρήκε το θάρρος να μιλήσει ξανά για το δικό της εφιάλτη, για τον πατέρα Paul. Αυτή τη φορά πήγε στην Αρχιεπισκοπή του Δουβλίνου, αλλά και στην αστυνομία.
I found out that he was in a parish. He was looking after children. He was, at that point, still active, and still in a position of trust with children. And I tried to get the Archbishop of Dublin, who was Archbishop Connell at the time, I asked him to have him removed from his parish, and he wouldn't. The priest admitted that he had abused me, so his superiors knew he was guilty, but they still wouldn't cooperate with the police.
As an 11, 12-year-old boy, I wasn't going home to discuss sexual matters with my parents. And it was also, you know, as a child in the 70s, it was what word would I even use? I wouldn't have even known what words to use to say to somebody what was happening. And also there was the thought of, if you tell, well, who do you tell, and then what do you tell, and then if you tell somebody, does that mean everybody finds out? That made me feel very inhibited then, and it also made me feel very inhibited about myself physically. So I had very, you know, at a time when I was 15 or 16, young, blonde, probably relatively handsome, good looking, but I felt ugly. I felt very unattractive. I covered myself up. I wore black all the time.
Ο Άντριου Μάρντεν, ένα παπαδοπαίδη στην ενορίασά των του Δουβλίνου, υπέμενε επί 2,5 χρόνια το μαρτύριο της σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης. Ο ιερέας Ιβάν Πέιν εκμεταλλευόταν τη σιωπή, τη σύγχυση και την τροπή του παιδιού. Το 1981, όταν ο Άντριου έγινε 17 ετών, αποκάλυψε την αρρωστημένη συμπεριφορά του πατέρα Πέιν σε έναν καθηγητή του. Εκείνος κατήγγειλε την κακοποίηση στην Αρχιεπισκοπή και έλαβε τη δέσμευση ότι θα ληφθούν μέτρα, ότι το θέμα θα τακτοποιηθεί. Ο καιρός περνούσε όμως και ο ιερέας εξακολουθούσε να λειτουργεί κανονικά στην εκκλησία.
And he went back to Archbishop's house and said, what are you doing with this priest? And they said they would move him at a time when they normally moved priests in order not to draw attention to him particularly. A year after I left school, I made my own application to join the priesthood, and I was eventually turned down. So that was a very shocking experience for me. I knew that they had allowed Ivan Payne carry on be a priest, so I already felt very bad about myself, and now I was learning that this child molester was more suitable for the priesthood than I was, and somewhere in my mind that was really very, very damaging to me as a person. And shortly after that, I started drinking.
Αρχές της δεκαετίας του 90, ο Μάρντεν αποφασίζει να σύρει τον πατέρα Πέιν στα δικαστήρια. Δύο χρόνια μετά, οι δικηγόροι των δύο πλευρών καταλήγουν σε συμβιβασμό. Ο ιερέας θα πλήρωνε ένα ποσό της τάξης των 35.000 ευρώ και ο Μάρντεν δεν θα μιλούσε ποτέ ξανά για την κακοποίησή του.
And we subsequently learned then in 1995 that the Archbishop of Dublin, Archbishop Connell, had used diocesan funds to give to Ivan Payne to pay the compensation.
Τον Απρίλιο του 1995, με συνέντευξή του στην εφημερίδα Irish Press, ο Άντριου Μάρντεν γίνεται ο πρώτος Ιρλανδός που μιλά ανοιχτά και δημόσια για τη σεξουαλική κακοποίησή του από καθολικό ιερέα. Μια βροχή από δημοσιεύματα και τηλεοπτικά ντοκιμαντέρ, όπως το «Καταστάσεις φόβου» της Ράφτερη, σηματοδοτούν το τέλος της σιωπής για τα ένοχα μυστικά της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας στην Ιρλανδία. Οι αποκαλύψεις αναγκάζουν την κυβέρνηση να συστήσει επιτροπές για τη διερεύνηση των καταγγελιών σχετικά με τα ιδρύματα της Εκκλησίας, αλλά και την αποκατάσταση των θυμάτων. Τα μέτρα, ανακοινώνει ο τότε πρωθυπουργός Μπέρντι Άχερν, μαζί με τη δημόσια απολογία του για την ολιγορία της πολιτείας εδώ και δεκαετίες.
The government wishes to make a sincere and long overdue apology to the victims of childhood abuse for a collective failure to intervene, to detect their pain and to come to the rescue.
We put the church on a pedestal. We made them more important than what they were. We looked up to them. And because we thought they were good, religious and kind people, we trusted them. I don't think this, I think the state knew some of the things it had to know. But when some people would escape, like when a boy when I was there, who was raped, he went to the police. The police didn't believe him. The government didn't believe him. Even wrote to his member of parliament, didn't believe him.
Η έρευνα για τα ιδρύματα της Εκκλησίας την περίοδο 1937-1980 αρχίζει τελικά τον Μάιο του 2000. Στην εισαγγελέα Λαφόη και αργότερα στον εισαγγελέα Ράιαν εμφανίζονται και ζητούν να καταθέσουν περισσότερα από 3.000 θύματα. Η απροθυμία των χριστιανικών ταγμάτων όμως να συνεργαστούν με τις αρχές, αλλά και η απειλή τους ότι θα αμφισβητήσουν δικαστικά κάθε καταγγελία εναντίον τους, καθυστερεί την έκδοση του πορίσματος.
Because the religious orders decided to fight every case, they denied every allegation. They even denied that children were in the schools. They denied that they were in the schools. They denied, the level of denial was shocking. This is what they threatened, unless they got their way, which was that nobody would be named, and crucially, no dead brothers would be named, no living brothers would be named, nobody.
Οι αρχές δέχθηκαν τον εκβιασμό προκειμένου να προχωρήσει η διαδικασία. Χρειάστηκαν 9 ολόκληρα χρόνια για να ολοκληρωθεί η γνωστή και ως αναφορά Ράιν. Όταν δόθηκε στη δημοσιότητα τον Μάιο του 2009, τα ονόματα των ιερέων, των μοναχών και των αδελφών που είχαν κακοποιήσει παιδιά είχαν αντικατασταθεί με ψευδόνυμα.
This document, this inquiry vindicates what victims had said. It mentions where children were raped and brutally abused. And victims will feel vindicated by that. That will give them some comfort. However, this report's conclusions go very, very, very short on the what the expectations of the victims wanted. Didn't name, didn't shame, didn't say anything. That is wrong. Those who were dead, even those who were dead, they didn't reveal their names, and they could. Then there's no law being broken. But the man who was here, who worked in the laundry, they gave him a pseudonym. He's dead. He died in prison. Why not mention him now, his name? I can say it. His name is Brother Gallagher. They call him Brother Raymond. They call him something else. All these people different names, not to identify. Why? Oh, they say, to protect his family. What about my family?
You know, one of the most extraordinarily damning conclusions ever anywhere about the Catholic Church on such a scale, talking about endemic, systematic, widespread, whole-scale abuse of tens of thousands of children by members of religious orders. And the Vatican is completely silent on this.
Το Cardinal Secrets, το ντοκιμαντέρ της Mary Raftery, έγινε η αφορμή για τη δεύτερη μεγάλη επίσημη έρευνα στην Ιρλανδία. Η επωνομαζόμενη Επιτροπή Murphy ανέλαβε να ρίξει φως στα σκάνδαλα σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης αλλά και στο χειρισμό τους σε μια από τις μεγαλύτερες καθολικές αρχιεπισκοπές στον κόσμο, στην Αρχιεπισκοπή του Δουβλίνου.
Bishops knew, archbishops knew, parish priests knew, monsignors knew, everybody at every senior level. And we had one case where before it never got anywhere, of course, because it never got to case, but one mother calculated, she totted them up on her fingers, she had told 7 priests, 2 monsignors, 2 bishops, 2 auxiliary bishops, and an archbishop knew about this priest who was going around abusing kids. He was moved to another parish where he carried on abusing kids, moved again to another parish, carried on abusing kids. Extraordinary litanies of this kind of covering. So we told these in Cardinal Secrets in 2002.
Ο φάκελος της Επιτροπής Murphy άνοιξε τελικά το 2005. Τα συμπεράσματα δημοσιοποιήθηκαν 4 χρόνια αργότερα, το Νοέμβριο του 2009. Η Επιτροπή εξέτασε εκατοντάδες καταγγελίες σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης εναντίον 172 κληρικών. Ανάμεσά τους, με το ψευδόνυμο Πάτερ Έντμοντους, ήταν ο πατέρας Πολ Μαγκένης, ο βιαστής της Μέρι Κόλμης.
it turns out that the diocese had details on this priest's file of him abusing children in the hospital the same year as I was abused. So they actually knew he was an abuser already. They'd known 35 years before that he was an abuser, but they'd never done anything about it. Now he's in his 70s. But, I mean, that man alone must have had hundreds of victims over 30, 40 years. And they could have stopped him 2 months after my abuse. And when I challenged the Archbishop, who later became Cardinal, Cardinal Connell, when I challenged him in a face-to-face meeting and said, why are you leaving children at risk? And why are you not cooperating with the police? His attitude was, I couldn't ruin this man's life. He was entitled to his good name.
Στην αναφορά Μέρφη εμφανιζόταν ένας ακόμη γνωστός ιερέας. Ο πατέρας Πέιν. Ο άνθρωπος που κακοποιούσε τον Άντριου Μάδεν.
Well, if the church hadn't covered up for him in 1981, he couldn't have gone on to sexually abuse more children. And the Murphy report identified at least 7 boys who were sexually abused by Ivan Payne after he had been moved to Sutton.
Obviously, what happened to the children made you cry. You know, you shouldn't even read it because you'll never sleep again. Before I read any of this stuff, I was a person who had to sleep in pitch black or I couldn't sleep. Since I read the stuff back in March, I have to have a light on. Can't go to sleep without the light on. The stuff didn't even happen to me. That's just from reading it, you know. So it's really very upsetting, you know.
Η Ιρλανδή τραγουδοποιός Sinéad O'Connor ήταν από τις πρώτες φωνές που υψώθηκαν ενάντια στη σεξουαλική κακοποίηση από καθολικούς ιερείς. Το 1992, λίγες μέρες μετά την ευνηδιαστική κίνησή της να ασκήσει τη φωτογραφία του Πάπα Ιωάννη Παύλου σε ζωντανό πρόγραμμα του αμερικανικού δικτύου NBC, εμφανίστηκε σε συναυλία όπου δέχτηκε τις αποδοκιμασίες πιστών καθολικών.
I just cried and cried and cried. When I read the Murphy report, I cried for like 2 weeks, like. And I was very angry as well, obviously. You know.
Why were you so angry about it?
Well,
was it something personal, you know?
No, it's a wealth of reasons. For me, the reason I'm involved in this whole campaigning or struggling about it is not only because I'm concerned about the people that this stuff happened to, but I happen to be someone who loves the idea of the Holy Spirit. You know, and I believe in the Holy Spirit, and I don't like to see that spirit being used and manipulated and misrepresented. And I always had the feeling the church kind of keep the Holy Spirit prisoner, you know, hold him hostage, or him, she, it, whatever you want to call it, that they dictate who God can love and who God doesn't love and all of that. So I was always disappointed with them. And from the time that I was very young, I grew up myself in a home which was filled with extreme abuse. And what actually helped me to get through that was the Holy Spirit. I constantly believed in Jesus. When I was having this shit kicked out of me, lying on floors, I'd close my eyes and I'd think about Jesus, and I'd see Jesus on the cross, and the blood would run down from Jesus into my heart on the floor, and that saved me. I was able to go through any abuse when I had that.
Ένα από τα πιο τραγικά στοιχεία της αναφοράς Μέρφη είναι η αποκάλυψη ότι το 1987 σχεδόν κάθε επισκοπή της Ιρλανδίας ζήτησε τη συνδρομή μιας ασφαλιστικής εταιρείας που έλεγχε η Εκκλησία, της Church in General. Αιτία ήταν το κύμα καταγγελιών για σεξουαλικές κακοποιήσεις που εκείνη την εποχή ερχόταν από τις Ηνωμένες Πολιτείες.
So they insured themselves against compensation claims. What they didn't do was they didn't change their policy of moving priests from parish to parish once they were accused of abuse. They didn't change their policy of refusing to tell the civil authorities and the police about them so that they could be put in jail. They didn't change their policy of constantly denying to the child victims and their parents that anything was wrong. I mean, that what parents and children met was a wall of denial. And so they were told in Ireland and everywhere else in the world, you're liars, you're making this up. This is not true. No priest would ever do this.
Power. It is, it was a Catholic historian in the 19th century, a British, English Catholic historian, Lord Acton, who coined the phrase, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. The Catholic Church had absolute power in this island, certainly in the Republic, in this state. They ignored church law, they ignored state law, they could do what they liked, and they did what they liked. They brushed under the carpet, moved these guys around to protect the reputation of the institution and its resources and its assets and its most important people, the priests.
The church is damaged. It's damaged not for what these people did to the children, the abusers, the paedophiles. The church is damaged because the cardinals, the bishops, the Pope does not accept responsibility that they got it wrong.
So I think it'll be over when these people admit that they lied, when they admit that they're now trying to cover up the cover-up, when they turn themselves into the police and ask to be prosecuted, every one of them, from the Pope down. They all knew, they all covered up, they didn't give a damn about rape of children. And I don't like, say, when people say abuse. That waters down what we're actually talking about here. And it's a horrible image to think of, but just imagine some small boy that you know, or a boy of any age, being raped by anyone, never mind that it's a priest.
Οι απόψεις της Sinéad O'Connor ακούγονται υπερβολικές ορισμένες φορές, αλλά είναι οι απόψεις του καλλιτέχνη, απόψεις χρήσιμες για την ευαισθητοποίηση μιας κοινωνίας απέναντι σε τέτοιου είδους περιστατικά, που σε κάθε περίπτωση δεν χαρακτηρίζουν το σύνολο της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας και του δόγματος. Οι πιο ψύχρεμες επικριτικές φωνές ακούγονται από το εσωτερικό της Ιρλανδικής Εκκλησίας. Ο Άντριου Φέγγαν, εκπρόσωπος της Αρχιεπισκοπής του Δουβλίνου και της Υπηρεσίας για την Προστασία Παιδιών που ιδρύθηκε το 2003, παραδέχεται τα σφάλματα του παρελθόντος και το Γολγοθά που έχουν τώρα μπροστά τους πιστοί και Εκκλησία.
I suppose, and this is something that the Murphy report has highlighted, there was the concern for the reputation of the church and a sense that, you know, if we could somehow deal with these matters without making too big of a deal of it, well, so much the better. That was clearly a mistake. I think that the impact of the Murphy report has been huge, not just for people who've experienced abuse, but for the church generally. The revelations have been so horrific and so extensive that it has done major damage to the standing of the church. And it's incredibly painful, I think, for members of the church. And to think in terms of recovering from that, that's a long-term process. It really is a long-term process. The head of the Catholic Church in the world has acknowledged that the abuse has happened, has apologized for it, has acknowledged that it was not well handled in the Archdiocese of Dublin. And all of those things are very important in terms of the restoration of trust in the church.
Ήταν τέτοια η προσπάθεια της Ιρλανδικής Καθολικής Εκκλησίας να αποποιηθεί τις ευθύνες της για τα σκάνδαλα σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης, που το 2000 συνέταξε μια αναφορά για τις κακοποιήσεις σε ολόκληρη την Ιρλανδία.
Σκοπός αυτής της αναφοράς ήταν να καταδείξει ότι οι κακοποιήσεις δεν είναι μόνο πρόβλημα της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας, αλλά της ίδιας της Ιρλανδικής κοινωνίας στο σύνολό της. Το ερώτημα είναι τι γνώριζε και τι έκανε όλα αυτά τα χρόνια η Αγία Έδρα. Η συνάντηση των Ιρλανδών Επισκόπων με τον Ποντίφικα, η αποστολή 4 καρδιναλίων στο Δουβλίνο και η επιστολή με τη συγγνώμη του ίδιου του Πάπα προς τους καθολικούς της Ιρλανδίας είναι δύσκολο να δώσουν απαντήσεις στις καταγγελίες των θυμάτων για συγκάλυψη, την ώρα μάλιστα που συνεχίζονται οι αποκαλύψεις για το ρόλο του Βατικανού στην τραγωδία της Ιρλανδίας.
My name is Brian Darcy. I'm a priest, a Passionist congregation. As a young child, I was abused by a Christian brother, and later in life, I was abused by a priest. And when the first time I read the Ryan report, I had no problem believing it, that this was done by people who were supposed to be serving God and who brutalized the innocent people, who had many of whom had been brutalized in their own home beforehand. The Ryan report indicated that people who had given their entire lives at the service of God had in fact, on the one hand, abused children, and on the other hand, which is just as evil, people who knew that that happened did nothing to stop it and sometimes encouraged the activity of it. One of the most serious allegations that we have to face, and one of the most serious conclusions from this Dublin report that we have to face, is that this was a systemic failure. The system itself in Dublin and in Ireland and in Rome and universally across the church is such that it is dysfunctional. Don't forget, all of these leaders in Ireland and throughout the world were specifically chosen by Rome themselves as being the kind of men they wanted. Yes, men. Men who will not rock the boat. Men who will are easily manipulated, and men who will do what Rome tells them. It was Rome who chose them, so therefore Rome has to take the responsibility for it. So far, that hasn't happened. And I still can't understand why the Pope can't come out and say, first of all, I accept the veracity, the truth of Ryan. I accept the veracity and the truth of the Dublin Archdiocese report into sexual abuse. You know, and that hasn't happened. So we're still in this world of denial.
As you know, in recent months, the church in Ireland has been severely shaken as a result of the child abuse crisis. As a sign of my deep concern, I have written a pastoral letter dealing with this painful situation.
Ένα μήνα μετά την πρόσκληση των Ιρλανδών Επισκόπων στο Βατικανό, ο Πάπας Βενέδικτος ανακοινώνει την αποστολή μιας επιτροπής 4 καρδιναλίων σε επισκοπές της Ιρλανδίας. Η λεγόμενη Αποστολική Επίσκεψη σκοπεύει να ερευνήσει σε βάθος, για λογαριασμό της Αγίας Έδρας, τα ζητήματα που έχουν προκύψει από τις καταγγελίες εναντίον της Εκκλησίας. Ο Ποντίφικας ανακοινώνει την Αποστολική Επίσκεψη σε μια ανοιχτή επιστολή προς όλους τους καθολικούς της Ιρλανδίας, στην οποία πρωτίστως ζητά συγγνώμη. Η επιστολή διαβάζεται την Κυριακή των Βαΐων σε όλες τις εκκλησίες.
He apologized on behalf of those errant people, which is correct, but he made no apology for the errancy of the system over which he presides. And whereas that's the point that everybody was waiting for, he didn't accept that it was systemic failure. So I think that his letter was good, and probably as good as could come at the time, but there's much more to come. And I dread the thoughts of what a visitation is going to do, because I really, from visitations across the world, The result usually is a reimposition of Rome and blaming gay people and seminaries and lax theologians and women people. And it'll blame everybody else for this laxity. That's not what's going to be. That's not what happened there in church. The Irish church was ruined by clerics who were appointed by Rome to rule it.
For a start, we got apology. It took 300 years after Galileo's death before he got an apology. I got one in my lifetime. And all the thousands of victims who know, we got one in our lifetime. That is an astonishing thing for the Pope to have done. Surrender yourself to demands of justice. That's what Pope Benedict said. I think His Holiness was sincere in this. Now, it's open to interpretation how you would do that.
He showed how concerned he was and he did apologise, but what survivors like myself were looking for was him to say he was going to make his bishops take responsibility. Any man who had protected an abuser would be made to resign, would be stepped down. So we wanted actions as well as words. We didn't get that in the letter.
I was angry about the Pope's letter because it just was insult after insult to our intelligence. It was a study in the art of lying. It was pure lying. You know, it starts with a lie. Oh, I'm concerned to have heard, I'm as concerned as you to have heard these things, as if he only bloody just heard it when we did. They knew about it decades ago, you know.
And then to have a Pope come along and say, well, it's because you didn't really believe enough in God that all this happened to you. You know, it really makes people say, oh, what is he talking about? You know, this has no relevance to us. Like, he doesn't get it. He doesn't really understand it.
I don't know if it's fair for anybody to criticise Pope Benedict for not understanding the full thing. I mean, I lived in the middle of Ireland and I didn't understand it. And didn't understand that it was such a huge problem. What you can expect better leadership from is when you find out the truth, not to accept it. And there's been a real sharp hesitancy, not really from Pope Benedict himself, but from the organization of which he is the head, to accept the truth. A crime is a crime. The problem with the church was that they confused crime with sin, and they thought they could help and forgive sin, forgetting that crime was something else. We can't undo it. We can't make up for it. We can't compensate for it. We can make efforts at all of those things. But eventually, we can't sort of set up a system to help survivors and walk away as if it never happened and say, which we've done everything. What do you want us to do now?
Η Επιτροπή που συνέστησε το Ιρλανδικό κράτος για τα θύματα σεξουαλικής κακοποίησης στα ιδρύματα της Καθολικής Εκκλησίας έχει αποζημιώσει μέχρι σήμερα συνολικά 14.000 ανθρώπους με 1.300.000.000 ευρώ. Η Εκκλησία, επικαλούμενη τα άδεια ταμεία της, έδωσε μόνο 120 εκατομμύρια ευρώ, δηλαδή λιγότερο από το 10% του συνολικού ποσού. Το 90% των αποζημιώσεων για τις σεξουαλικές κακοποιήσεις στα χριστιανικά ιδρύματα πλήρωσαν οι Ιρλανδοί φορολογούμενοι.
The bishop, the present bishop of Ferns, came out and stated, not asked, but stated that we, the Irish people, have a God-given duty to help the church to pay their compensation to the victims and to pay the church's legal fees, right? Now that shows you again, they don't give a shit. They're laughing at us. They think we're idiots, and they think that we will never understand that we deserve better.
I'm still angry with the church itself in that they are trying to portray this whole child abuse issue as some sort of a conspiracy against the church that's being led by the media, and that it's all an anti-church issue. they don't seem to take responsibility for the fact that it would not have happened if the leadership of the church had behaved as they should have done and had not protected abusers.
We have now discovered, not only did were the children abused in these institutions, we now know they were abused in parishes, dioceses around Ireland. But we also know now that they're abused all over the world, in different countries.
The reports in Dublin talk about every archbishop for three decades covering up the sexual abuse of children. The Boston report says the very same thing. Or the Philadelphia report, one of the two of them, talks about every archbishop for six decades covering up the sexual abuse of children. We change the names, you've got the very same thing going on, the very same practices engaged in.
Every country in the world has covered this up. Every bishop in the world almost has covered it up, has had some knowledge of it. So nobody's hands are particularly clean. And so then, of course, when you come to the current Pope Benedict, we know now, because of what's transpired in Germany, that he has serious questions to answer, which he has not yet addressed himself to. But also his knowledge within the Vatican, because he was, as the prefect of the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, previously, of course, known as the Inquisition, he was the repository of more knowledge about this than anybody else, and nothing filters its way back to civil police forces anywhere.